Hi, y'all, in the room and online. Thanks for that. I'm Brittany Sterling. I'm the Social Sciences and Interdisciplinary Studies Librarian. And I know you're wondering why I'm doing the SimBridge program. That's because I also am kind of the informal grad college liaison. So I will show you the people for whom you can actually ask research help during the course of this presentation. But sometimes I do get some interdisciplinary topics that come my way. So you, of course, can reach out to me, but your people are usually not me. Just clarifying that. So in case you're also curious about this outfit, I too am helping with Rebel Ready Week and I need to look like a cowgirl later. So that's what this is about, if anyone was curious. So I'm just gonna go over some like really quick kind of welcome to the school year things, sort of how you can best use the library to help you in your program. And then I usually do some live kind of showing you different places on the website that I don't ever want to assume people know already. So if you do know it already and it's a little redundant, please forgive. I just like to make sure that in a group this big, and also our group online, people may not have seen it, so we'll go over that. And then I will show you how to contact your librarians and also if you need tech help, because we have some special software over in the library that people don't always know that we have. And also, just it's helpful for y'all to know there are actually 4 libraries on this campus. LEED is the main one everybody knows. We have Art and Architecture, the TDRL Teacher Development Research Library. Sorry, I always mess it up. And then the Music Library. So if you are ever talking to a librarian or someone who works in the library, just make sure you clarify which one you need help from. And then we also have a health sciences library, which might be interesting to some of y'all depending on your research interests, but it's over on Shadow Lane, so you would have to go to our other campus. All right, moving on. So, of course, that's me. You can find me at brittany.sterling@unlv.edu. There are 2 Brittanys. Lucky for you, we don't look anything alike, so it's hard to mix me up with her. Okay, so I think at this level of, you know, your degree programs, you know kind of what the library is for. However, I know sometimes you see a librarian in like English 101 or 102 or something like that, and then you don't necessarily see them again, or you don't see them again until your capstone. So since y'all are now over in a grad program, I just want to reiterate some of the stuff we can help you with. So of course, things like reviewing the field, theory building and testing, reflecting and concluding, and what I mean by that is, some of you may have seen that I also help with Grad Rebel Writing Bootcamp, if you happen to participate in that. And what always happens after that for me is that someone books an appointment with me to help sort of clarify their project, especially if they are, you know, kind of further along in the dissertation phase. They might have this huge, like, this room encompassing idea, and they really need to get it to about half the size. So your librarian can also help you with those kinds of things, and not just the strictly research kind of thing. Sometimes it's helpful to just have an outside perspective on whatever conceptual idea that you have. Not that I don't believe any of you can't pull it off, but sometimes there's some intermediary parts that get lost in your kind of thinking them out. So remember, you can ask for that kind of thing too. And then of course there's citation management. I think at this level, y'all are probably okay on citations. But what I will say is that many of the associations are always coming out with new rules. So if that is being accurate is important to you, we can help with that too. Okay, so the other thing I like to warn people is to get the most out of your research consultation. I will tell you, mine are usually about 45 minutes. Some of my colleagues have, and I'll show you online one of them in particular, some people do as short as 30 minutes, some people can expand to 60 minutes, but everyone kind of, in the subject liaison areas anyway, they kind of create their own, they have the autonomy to create their own length of time or what they're going to cover. And so if you need a particularly long time, that's a thing you usually can email about. I will show you how to book an appointment before we're out of here so you can see what I'm talking about. But it's helpful to have a narrowed down idea of what you want to talk about. So for my area, because I'm interdisciplinary, a lot of times people come to me with these huge, huge research concepts and I meet with them multiple times because we need to break it down. In y'all's case, it might be a little more cut and dried, but it's helpful if you are coming in to refine methodology, if you have an idea of the few methodologies you want help thinking through, or if you need particular data sets, you wanna use someone else's data, you wanna create your own data, like having sort of knowing which part of the research process you want will just make the most of your time. And of course, you can always book multiple appointments with folks. But this is my caveat where I like to tell folks that librarians actually aren't sitting at their desks doing this waiting for questions. We're faculty here. And so we have our own sort of scholarship service and job duty requirements. And librarianship is in itself an interdisciplinary kind of job. So we end up having a lot of admin work and a lot of scholarship work and your scholarship work. So I always like to tell people to sort of book early and often, and also just don't assume that your librarian can like hop to your to answer your question immediately, because we're actually pretty busy over there. And then of course, plan ahead and give yourself some time. All right, so in a second, I will show you how to set up library consultations, which is probably most helpful for this group. How to find the librarian you need, who's probably not me, but you can also reach out to me if you need to. What they're able to help you with, how the scheduling system works, and then tips for having the best library experience. Okay, so just before we get to that part, I like to always give some sort of, I know that you're grown-up researchers and you know what to do, but the beginning of semesters are crazy, even for me on the faculty side. And these are some extensions that just kind of help me sort of narrow down time if you're distractible like I am. So you can go into the extension part of your, if you're using a Google browser, and look for any of these, just focus. If any of you know about the Pomodoro method, I'll talk about that in just a second, but it is a method where you work for 25 minutes and then you can be off for between 5 and 15 minutes, and that seems to help some people's focus. So if that's not a thing that you use now and you think it would be helpful, just offering it to the room is helpful for me sometimes. There are a few of these that are things like writing companions that remind you to get up and walk around. You have to do a lot of writing, or you're in your lab for an extended period of time. They're kind of like built-in timers you can build for yourself so you can remember to get up or eat or do some other things. Because sometimes we get into our work and then 8 hours later we haven't left the lab or left our seat, and that's not great. Okay, so just quickly, I mentioned the Pomodoro technique. You pick a task, set a 25-minute timer. You don't have to use an extension. You can just kind of use your own thing. And then you work until time is up, and then you take a break. Theoretically, you're supposed to do 4 rounds of this, and that is supposed to make you the most productive. That's helpful for you. Please take it. If you think that's ridiculous, you don't have to take it, but it helps me over in the library, so I thought I would mention it here. And let me click through these. Sorry, this is just a different example. So I also wanted to talk to y'all about literature tools. I don't know how everyone's feeling about AI things, but it feels like everyone is doing their own generative AI, this, that, and the other thing. Why am I mentioning this at the library? Because people think, I guess, librarians are very anti-AI. We actually have someone who is like our AI specialist, who I will mention to you. But some of this is like the helping get started bit that I think is, it doesn't have to be an either or. You can obviously use the databases to do the, to do what you need to do, and also use these tools to help with summarizing, or if you need to pull out the concepts and sort of make yourself a concept map because you don't have time to read 55 or 60 pages, I think that's okay. And so I just wanted to mention that, and I will mention a few more to you before I leave here. Because we are all very busy, and I know y'all have, you have research to do that will be, you know, changing the world, right? And so sometimes we gotta also use the time management to do those things. So I'll mention a few of those things. And then just a few other resources people don't know the library has. We have something called the research journey, which at your level you may look at and kind of think it's rudimentary, but the way it has been broken down is the steps of the research process and then the steps of the steps. So let's say you are, this has happened to me before, I, with a co-investigator of mine, we've chosen a methodology and thought the methodology would work. And then once we got to the point of analyzing our data, it just didn't, it wasn't the thing that made the most sense. So you can use the research journey to go back and kind of link out to other areas that might, that you might not have considered before. And it will help you sort of refine your practice. I use methodology because I think at this level, y'all will understand that, but there's also things much more rudimentary than that, like in the literature review bit, or how you're gonna disseminate. It gives advice about that as well. And that's a Canvas course that you can, if you are using Canvas for anything else, you can kind of add it to your list of courses, and it can just live there until you need it. Purdue Owl, I'm not sure if y'all have been told about in your classes, but I've been using Purdue Owl for citation management help since I was an undergrad, which is almost 20 years ago. I can't believe that. But people always say that because it is the best. They have a use case for every kind of weird citational thing you can think of, down to social media citations or interviews within like Patreon or something like that. So if you didn't know about it as a resource, it's not a UNLV resource, but you can just Google it and you can find it to help you out. Y'all probably won't be using these, but these are some peripheral programs if you're doing an interdisciplinary project that you can sort of look to for some help. We Need to Talk is a regular panel streamed series that we do in the library. I help with the research guides on the back end of that. And we do have some crossover things with STEM, like medical racism, some other sort of neurosciencey things, and we're always doing more episodes. So if you didn't know about that as a thing that the libraries do, it could come in handy for your research. You never know. And then there's also the Rebel Plus workshop series. I was, until recently, the coordinator of it, and its purpose is to be sort of a co-curricular skills building thing. So some of them are research-based, like how to choose a journal for publication, or I have a colleague who will teach you how to make the best of your ORCID profile, which is like a scholarly profile people can find you by. But then there are also things like LinkedIn for academics and sort of creating your digital footprint, if you will, within your area of expertise. Or things like, in the past, I've taught things like about the IRB process and how there's all these little minutiae things in between the big lessons that you need to know that will make your life easier if you know them from the beginning instead of having to learn by trial and error like I did. So if you didn't know that we had those things, we have those things. And hopefully they can be helpful to you in addition to your grad college workshops. All right, and then just because we are starting the semester, and we just had an announcement of this from President Whitfield the other day, just sort of referencing how campus has been made over since the events of December 6th. If there's anything, if you were here during that time and still struggling, or you just are curious to know what's being talked about there, you can go to unlvstrong.unlv.edu and kind of get an idea of what's going on and how things have improved since then. And I just like to always put this in my presentation because we're all at different places on the journey with acknowledging what happened that day. All right, so once again, this is my contact. I am Brittany with an I. The other Brittany is Brittany with a Y. I don't know if that will stick with you, but that's an easy way to differentiate us. If you have questions about setting up an appointment with me, once again, I am not explicitly STEM, but I do have a lot of work in interdisciplinary studies and multidisciplinary folks, so folks who are sort of making their own thing or really need, maybe you have an overarching STEM major and you are needing like the social aspect of that, I'm definitely your girl for the sociology and those kinds of things. So you can still come have a chat with me and see how you can work that together, and if I can't help you, I can definitely direct you to the correct colleague. So this is really kind of the end of my PowerPoint. I'm gonna take it to the library website, if that's okay. I just wanna point out some things you may or may not know about the library website. It has changed a bit over the summer, so hopefully this is not too redundant for y'all. First, let me show you the people you probably will want to book a research consultation with, because that's probably most important. So when you go to the library's website, which of course you can just use a little magnifying glass and look for, but it's always library.unlv.edu, you can go to help and support here. There are also several other widgets or sort of graphics that say meet with the librarian. You will go under consultation and instructions, and it's the first thing there. So here's what I'd like to point out to you first. So the first page will populate people who are on Maryland's campus, and that's usually who you'll want to meet with. However, because we do have health sciences colleagues over at Shadow Lane, especially if you are doing some sort of medical interdisciplinary project, you may end up wanting to have a chat with them, and you would need to click over to this tab to find them. You can also get help with lead technology consultations. So for instance, we used to have a data librarian. We're in the process of hiring a new one, so we do not have one, but we do have someone who can help you do data visualization and GIS work, if that would be helpful to your project. So you would need to make sure that you're looking for them under lead technology. And of course you can click through these things later and try to find the people. Let me show you what you'll see. I'm usually down at the bottom. I don't think this thing populates alphabetically. So it will just be a random mix of people. Let me show you my colleague Samantha, because I know that she has updated her appointments at this point. So when you click on schedule an appointment, what you will see is where you want to meet. So for those of you who haven't been over to the library yet, or those online who haven't been to the library, there is a big glass room in the middle next to the circulation desk that I like to call the fishbowl. If you book a research consultation, that's generally where you will meet someone if you want to meet in person. However, Samantha has smartly set it up to say she can also meet people at the Teacher Development and Resource Library because she's the education librarian. Sometimes she is over there instead of at LEAD. And then also a virtual consultation. I actually need to copy this and update mine. But you'd want to sort of, let's say you want to do a virtual one. She's got a little spiel about what she helps folks with. She helps folks with research and instruction related to education psychology and systematic reviews, which we have a sort of an interdisciplinary team of people who can help you with systematic and scoping reviews, if that's helpful to any of you over in STEM. I am just learning, but there are four other people who are really good at it. So you can always also book a consultation about that. It will show what's left. So it's showing her next available time is Wednesday. What you'd basically do is click one of these, click continue, and then you'd enter your details. As I've mentioned, she can do a consultation with you up to 60 minutes. And so you'll just wanna fill in your information. So what I'll tell you is, sometimes people interpret this upload slot as it needs to be like your syllabus or your assignment. If you are already far enough along your research project, like let's say you're figuring out your dissertation or you've already started it, you can add files you think would be relevant at the time, or like I mentioned, methodology as an example earlier. If you've got your method section written already and you want just some eyes on it, or you want some help trying to decipher if it seems like the best one or something like that, you can upload that there instead. And then you would confirm this appointment. And essentially what will happen is the system sends us, the librarian, that you've made a request. It marks the time on our calendar, and then we manually have to send you a calendar invite. That's the flaw in the system. It doesn't automatically send you one, but your librarian should be paying enough attention to do that. And honestly, that's kind of it. The folks you'll probably be wanting to talk to are my colleague Sue here. She does, her general title is engineering librarian, but as you can see, she can help with aerospace studies, computer science, entertainment engineering, and military science, in addition to some other things. We also have, let me keep scrolling, for Melissa. So this is Melissa. She is the math and sciences librarian, and she can help with biology, chemistry, geoscience, mathematics, physics, astronomy, and just like general science. So those two are the people who will be more the, I guess, like concrete physical science. And then I'll show you my colleague, Zan, if she populates here. Oh, there she is. So Zan does many, 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 many things, but she helps a lot with nursing, dental medicine, public health. She's often in this building, actually. Some of you may have met her or will meet her soon. And integrated health sciences. So she's kind of the Maryland version of our health sciences folks. They tend to help the people who are in medical school already and medical and dental residents. Zan is kind of the bridge. So if you, I guess depending on what your project may be, you may need one or the other. So those are gonna be the three you wanna schedule appointments with most of the time. That doesn't mean you can't schedule with anyone else. Depending on what your project is, my colleague Latika might also be someone who is helpful to you. She does all things careers. So if you're doing some research around STEM-related careers and you want to see how she can help, you'd be surprised what kinds of collection she has built around careers. It's not going to be like a career chat. It's like much different. So I just want to point those out to you. I don't want to overwhelm you with people. But it's mainly three, Sue, Zan, and Melissa are gonna be your three. And you can book any of them the same way I just showed you with Samantha's appointments. Let me just click through these real quick so you can see what it looks like.
At the top, can you click share this tab instead real quick?
Yes.
There we go.
So sorry, Zoom people, I'm sorry. Okay, so if you need a medical library consultation, you can also book with my colleagues, Katie or Anna. They kind of are having their roles are being reimagined right now, so you really could reach out to either one of them. You also can, I didn't mention this before, but we do have a makerspace in the library where if you are needing to do a physical manifestation of your project, you can go over there and do that. So let me actually back out of this and show you what that might look like. Okay, so spaces and technology. Let me see where it is. Oh, I guess I should point these other things out while I'm here. So you can, of course, reserve a study space. We do have some individual kind of, I know y'all have plenty of space in this building, so you don't need to come over to the library. But if you're gonna be in class and it would make more sense for you to stay over there instead of coming over, you can book study rooms. The Patent and Trademark Center, I wanted to mention to you all, based on, depending on what area of STEM you're in, you might be interested in how to patent or trademark your proprietary product or idea. You also can do that. You can make an appointment for that with my colleague Patrick. You can book group study spaces over there. And there's a map of everything that's available. So basically when you would click that, it will show you if a space is green, it's open. The library is fairly full every day. I will say at max capacity we see, y'all would be surprised, 5,000 to 8,000 people a day. So especially for study spaces, you might want to try booking in advance and not just assume it will be open. Of course, you can print, copy, scan over there. I wanted to point out to y'all the computer software and hardware while we're under this tab real quick, and then we'll get to the makerspace. So there are some specific computers over in LEED that might be helpful to you depending on what you're trying to do. So we have both Dells and Macs that have the special software, but it's limited to, I'd say there are probably 4 Macs and 4 Dells that have this stuff because it's pretty expensive. So of course, normal things like the Microsoft stuff, you can always get to the G Suite products. The Adobe Creative Cloud, the whole thing is over there. Atlas TI, if you're needing to use that to analyze anything. SPSS, Stata, Avid Pro Tools. Sorry. And then... Okay, I'm gonna keep going. I just wanted to make sure you didn't need to interject something or have a question. Okay, so we also have things like, you're gonna think are probably unrelated, but we have things like Final Cut Pro, Logic Pro, things like Xcode, and more SPSS Stata. We do have InVivo on some things, if that would be helpful at all for theming data, depending on how you're trying to. I know this is usually a quantitative crowd. I'm a qualitative girl, so I use those kinds of things. But we do have those things at our disposal if you're trying to do a mixed methods kind of study. And so I just wanted to point those out. The only thing about those is you do have to physically go over to the library and like sit down in front of one of those. I think it's 8 computers, maybe. So just keep that in mind. As far as the makerspace, since we're moving on, just some things to keep in mind. We have several things that might be of interest to you. Let's say you get the latitude to create a project where you create your own TV show, or you get to do something like make your own podcast or something like that. We do have a few podcast studios. There is a green space room. That's what these folks are doing, sort of creating their own TV show. We just got a whole bunch of 3D printers, if that's helpful to anyone to know. One set of them is bamboo, and I'm gonna forget the others. I just did this tour the other day, but we only had, I wanna say 5 of them before, and now we have more like 10 of them. They're also available over at Shadow Lane. You can go in there to vinyl cut. There's a sewing machine. There's, I don't know what you call the wood burner. I'm sure there's a better way to say that, but almost any creative expression for your research, if you're trying to visually demonstrate it, you can make over there. And if there's not a way, usually they'll work with you to figure it out. There's also tools that you can use if you need to build something, and a whole bunch of drafting tables, if that's helpful for anyone to make the physical manifestation of a product. I will say, before you can go over there, you do have to book an orientation, but they have them literally every day, except for this upcoming week when school will start. I'm sure the schedule is a bit wonky, but you've got to click this first-time user button, go through orientation, which is maybe 45 minutes, and then after that, you can just book your own things on this page. If you ever need help, you can also, under those technology appointments, you can book with our podcast studio person, especially David, really knows the ins and outs of that kind of stuff. Okay. Whoops. Patents and trademarks, which might be helpful to y'all. So we, UNLV has, I think, one of the only patent and trademark centers for a university out west, which is interesting. We just got, I don't know if certified is the correct language for that last fall, but you can make an appointment or do walk-in hours with my colleague Patrick. Before you go over there, you can look at some of these resources, but doing things like, especially if you're trying to make a physical manifestation of something related to your research, and you want to patent it, he can teach you how to use the patent public search or the test search to see if someone else already has done it, or how you can sort of, if you have a very similar idea, how you can still make, sort of protect yours while someone else has the idea that you originally did. They did also just get their own grad student, so I think they'll be expanding programming there, and they might be doing a bunch of other things. You also can have a look at the research guide. A lot of the ways that we sort of give this information outside of in-person things like this is to have a staid research guide, which I'll show you next, which you can access anytime from any place at home or on campus. For most things, if you need assistance, people's information is here. I will say you can try calling people in their offices, but like I said, we're sometimes running around. So if you ever do try to call us in our offices and we're not there, it is not blowing you off. We're just quite a busy library. Okay. Main things, because I'm keeping my eye on the time and I want to show y'all some actual databases. So if you are just trying to get some maybe background information on the research, like doing lit review things or just some background on parts of your research you think need some shoring up, the easiest way to do that is to go to, I would say I'm going to show y'all these research guides first since I just mentioned them. As you can see, we have them for not every single niche of a discipline, but for many, many, many things. Let's look at chemistry and biochemistry, just for the sake of example. Sometimes you will see links that have a number next to them. That usually means they've been created for a course, whatever that course number is. You're still welcome to use them, just know they're probably targeted to whatever that instructor was wanting instead of these generic ones. So once again, here's Melissa. You can see that she's talking about a starting point for chemistry and biochemistry. And what usually we'll show here is sort of the best bets of databases for you to use if you're unfamiliar with them. So here she's recommending SciFinder, Scholar, Web of Science, which is sort of our probably most interdisciplinary STEM database. So if you've not used Web of Science before, I would highly recommend that to y'all in this room. And then we do have things like, for instance, the CRC Handbook of Chemistry and Physics, or earlier I was looking up for the engineers in case there were engineers in this session. We have a database called Access Engineering, which has past iterations of engineering books or books about strain and entropy, that kind of thing. So it doesn't seem like you might need those things, but believe it or not, sometimes you get stuck, you need the technical definition of something, they might come in handy. So I'm just gonna demonstrate what's on most of these so you have an idea. You can find articles and databases, so it'll take you to those databases so you don't have to go looking yourself. Here, she's kind of separated them out between literature and references, so that might be helpful. Usually people will include some sort of web resources thing, so these are not necessarily scholarly and owned by UNLV, but either maybe trade things or things that might be helpful background information that you can trust and not just someone's made up article about something. So here she's got things like the National Center of Biotechnology Information, the National Institute of Standards and Technology. So actual usable things, just not UNLV backed sources per se. Then we've got finding books, which I always tell people in my research consultations. You can, of course, go over to the stacks. She's got this nifty guide for you of where to find what you need to find if you need an actual physical book. We do also have a bunch of ebooks from 2020 till now. We do buy them anyway, but we really upped the purchases of them. So if you are looking in the quick search or in one of these databases and a book comes up, don't knock it. There are ways for you to sort of skim through it without having to read the whole thing. There are table of contents, you can look at subsections, and sometimes they're more helpful than articles, actually. We've got citing sources, which I'm sure at this point y'all are pretty well versed at citing your sources, but at least in my disciplines, people are always wanting different things. So it never hurts to look at these citation guides. Of course, I mentioned Purdue OWL, but there's also some UNLV libraries and Writing Center links in here. And then there are several iterations where this Ask Us button exists. It's also on the main page. Someone is normally on chat reference from, I want to say, 9 to 7. Don't quote me. Our hours have been wonky lately. 9 to 7 or 8, something like that. If you have a real quick question you need to ask someone, you can click anywhere that this exists, and someone should be able to answer it. Depending on its level of complication now. I will say if it's a complicated question, what they'll do is create a ticket and it will go to the librarian that makes the most sense to answer it for you. So you might have to wait a little bit. But like, for instance here, these are very generic questions, but we have sort of our own FAQ guide in the library, and that's what these kind of are. If they're more like process questions, or say you can't find an article that it says we own, it may be an interlibrary loan, which means we need to get it from somewhere else. These are kind of what these are for. So you're not just kind of like, why does this not show up? Okay. The next thing I wanted to show y'all is just some rudimentary database sort of searches. I'm sure that most of you have probably done this and know what it looks like, but people don't always know the easiest ways to find their subjects. So you, of course, can go to all subjects and kind of just use the drop down, of course. If you do that, let's choose a different form of STEM instead of chemistry this time. We'll do environmental studies just to change it up. So if you were to look by your subject area, what you'd end up seeing is we've got 31 databases that have something to do with environmental studies. It'll usually give you the best bets here up at the top. The number of best bets kind of depends on the discipline. So like here we've got Agriculture Environmental Science Database, Green File, Green Wire Environment, Energy Daily, and Climate Wire. They all have a little description underneath of why they are the best bet or why they're coming up as the thing that's probably most helpful to you. And then you'll get an A to Z list of all the other ones that are linked somehow to environmental science. So interestingly, I think it's funny that I'm listed as this. Here, environmental studies falls under interdisciplinary gender and ethnic studies, so that's probably why. If you're an environmental studies person and you need some more physical science help, I will find the right person to help you. But that's just for the sake of example. Sometimes there's also this getting started link over on the side, which usually lists in some sort of interdisciplinary kind of catch-all database, just for you to get started. And then if you've got problems, you can report a problem or get help. I also did not mention the quick search to y'all, but the quick search is kind of like the library's Google bar. If you are just getting started on some subject or some sub-niche of a subject you didn't think you were going to talk about, you can always use the quick search to do a rudimentary search of everything we own, which I will just warn is millions and millions of things, and you will get back some information that way as well. The other way that you can search, let me take this off and just make it generic to all subjects. So another way that you can search is by database types, if that makes more sense to your brain. So for instance, you can see here we've got a category that is chemical substance and materials properties. We have encyclopedias and dictionaries, which once again, sometimes a good definition. You wouldn't think that you need at this level, but sometimes you do. We have images of things here, we've got industry surveys, we have laws and court cases, which may not seem like a thing that crosses over, but that's kind of where my interdisciplinary-ness comes in handy. So I can help you find more than just the literal outcomes of experiments if you ever need that. We've got letters and diaries, literary criticism reports. We also get polls and data sets. So you can also look by statistics and poll data. And then we have actually a lot of streaming databases, which I know aren't generally considered like the most scholarly thing over in STEM. However, all of them are segments by scientists. So if you ever are in the need to cite them, they wouldn't just be like a YouTube video or something like that. Okay. I think that is enough about research borrow requests. I've been talking a while. Does anyone have questions before I go on? Yeah.
Can you talk about the can mm-hmm. borrow
a loan
from the library.
Yes.
So I want to know more about that.
Sure. So let me show you, just so you can see what equipment we have. That's a great question. So if you want to have an idea of what equipment we have to loan out, we've got this technology tab. You can, at any point, y'all can come over and borrow the laptops. There was just no way for me to check them out and bring them over here under me. They have to go out individually. But it will give you things like the loan terms, when you need to turn them in, if it's a 7-day loan, a 3-day loan. I will say if you check out a book, you usually get to keep it up to the end of the semester unless someone else requests it. So that's sometimes nice to know. With laptops, it's a 1-day loan. So you can, to maximize them, I would say if you can go over there in the morning and then turn it in by the evening whenever you leave, that makes sense. If not, it'll start sending you nagging emails and fines, so you can bring it back. But you can also look at technology by category. So we do have assistive technologies like screen readers and things like that. There are audio accessories. I'm not gonna lie, I'm less well-versed in those because you're probably checking them out at circulation, getting them from the makerspace, to be honest. But we do have certain kinds of headphones and things like that. Cables, chargers, and adapters, they're mostly the most recent up-to-date, except for the one that goes to my laptop, as I discovered the other day. But if you ever forget something or something like that, you can always come over and check one out. Got calculators, camera accessories, computer accessories, digital microscopes, video cameras, drawing and design tools. We do have someone who actually works right next door to me who's interested in gamification of things. So there are gaming things you can check out. We do have tablets as well. You can check out musical instruments, presentation things, and virtual reality. We also have, if any of you are doing any sort of medical related project, there are anatomical models, I was trying to think of the word, that you can check out for a bit. And we do have something called an anatomage table over there, if that's interesting to anyone, which is a big digital screen, for lack of a better way to put it, where you can look at different parts of the body and sort of, you can both do anatomical practice, I guess, like maybe memorization things, and also diagnoses. So if you're doing any sort of interdisciplinary medical thing, you could go over and also use that. Anybody got equipment questions beside the laptops? No? Okay. Okay, let me just look really quickly and see if there's anything else I think is super worth mentioning to y'all. Yes, go ahead.
Can you discuss interlibrary loans?
Sure, yes. That's where I was gonna go next if I didn't have any more physical items. Hang on just a second. Okay, so there's something called interlibrary loan, which is kind of like the, if we have something that comes up in our database, but you're having a hard time either finding the PDF to open, or it seems like it's coming up, but we don't own it, you may have to do something called interlibrary loan. We are in a consortium of Western institutions called GWILA, for lack of better, for the Cliff Notes version, and that means that what they own, we own, what we own, they own, kind of. So we've agreed for sort of a discounted price to exchange those things, because the back end of libraries is complicated, but even though libraries are made for borrowing, everything comes at a cost. So if you do need to ILL something, which is what we call in the library, let me show you how to do that. Let's see, where is it? Sorry, bear with me, y'all. They literally just changed this, and everything is different. Houston, if you catch it first, let me know.
Could it be under borrowless?
It may. Request from another library. That's what it is. It used to just say interlibrary loan, so there's that. Okay, so if you need to ILL something, this is the page you'll want to go to. You do have to create an account, and I will say, I didn't mention with some of these databases, when you try to open them, they will say you need to create an account. You haven't done anything wrong. We've just paid for a certain number of licenses, and they need to count you as a user of that license. So if that happens in the databases, just fill out the information. It's okay, and then it will let you open the thing. In this case, you've got to go into an ILL account. Let me see if I can log into mine real quick. We'll see. It may not let me because I'm under Sage. Okay. So this is basically what you'll see. There is new requests that you can make. If you have a history of other ones, you may be able to go back and find them if they're digitized files. It should show you your electronically received things. Sometimes these things are in a book and they need to be digitized, like physically by someone, and sometimes they've already been digitized, let's say in someone's special collections or something like that, and they just need to physically go in and send it to you. So you would be able to keep track of them here. Things that are checked out and outstanding requests. So of course, if let's say an article is super popular and you can't seem to get your hands on it, but you get your hands on it here instead, then you can sort of get rid of your request. Let me show you how you would make one. So you click on new requests. Let's just do an article because I could, yeah. So if you already know the title, the author, the journal number, if you, for instance, are given this information by one of your advisors or your instructors, you can go ahead and put these things in here. If you don't know all of that, just fill out as much as you know. Usually by title and author, we're okay, but there are a lot of like databases that pop up in libraries, so it's just helpful the more information that you have. And then if you have notes of any kind, say for instance, someone only has something in a bound journal and for whatever reason you don't want it like that, you can note that there. You'll submit the request and then you should just get an email update when it is ready for you, basically.
Yes. How long does it take for articles and for physical books to be sent through interlibrary loan?
Sure. So usually with articles, it's like a day or two. Of course, if you do it at, you know, like Friday at 4 p.m., you're not going to get it the next day, but normally, because they're just digitized, they can get to you pretty quickly. As far as the books, it depends on a lot of factors, because if someone has it checked out, we got to recall it, and hopefully they'll turn it in on time. Then we process it and get it to you. It's the same if someone made an ILL request from us. But generally speaking, if it's not checked out, I would say probably about a week. It depends on how far it's coming from, because that consortium is basically all the states west of the Rockies. So if it's coming from the upper northwest tip of Washington, it might take time. There's also costs involved on the back end of this stuff. So even though we're sharing, like there's a little bit of negotiating on that too, and that's the thing that kind of takes some time. So if you do need to ILL a book especially, I would do that earlier than later. Yes.
Cost to the library, but free to them.
Yes, yes, yes. Sorry to clarify that. It's a back-end cost to the library, but it is free to y'all. It just sometimes adds to the timeline, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Can I make a stupid question?
No stupid questions.
It's just because our student group can access all the information and databases in the library website in our house, because like in Brazil, we just can access inside the library. We can't access in our home. Like,
okay.
It's possible?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is. So things that are helpful to know, if you actually are either in the library is the most accessible, but if you're in any campus building with Wi-Fi, you should be able to view the databases in the library page as if you're in the library. When you go to your house, you can pull it up exactly the same way. The only thing that I would mention is there's a sign-in tab on the library website that lets you save things more easily. You don't have to sign in when you're on campus. It makes sense to sign in when you're at home, because it's harder to save things at home if you have not signed in. But yes, you can do it from where.
I need to pay something for that?
No, you don't. It's just your ACE account. Like once you've signed in with ACE, generally speaking, you are signed in. So, yep. You can access them from honestly anywhere with your. I've been at conferences in other countries doing UNLV work.
This is really so, nice, because for us there is really hard.
Yes. So that's a great question, actually.
Oh, and I imagine it was stupid.
No, never.
No stupid questions.
Anyone else?
Show the list of softwares that we have access to.
Yes.
Can you also install them in your personal computer?
So unfortunately, we don't have that model here. But what I will say is you can always come over to the library, or there is under the help and support, I think there's a link for the IT department. You can always send them an email. So I will say, before I worked here, I worked at Georgia State, and they sort of had open access for everyone to do that. It's really, really, really expensive. So we don't have that here, but there are times where we have, let's say, 10 licenses of something and we're not using all 10. if you have a meeting with the library IT person and you say, like, for instance, I needed Atlas TI on my computer. I need Atlas TI for this project for this number of months, blah, blah, blah. If we have a free license, sometimes they will just install it for you. So it can happen, but it's not a blanket yes, because we have so many thousands of students, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Anyone else?
Yeah. It's more like for the to schedule something inside the university.
Sure.
I visited there, but it was empty, more okay. like now this week.
Okay.
And to use like that save and sound space,
uh-huh.
to use other room or something like that for specific meetings,
mm-hmm.
Where we can schedule that. It's possible to schedule that.
Yes.
If not.
No, it totally is. Let me show you. Let me go back. It's a good question, because I showed you kind of around it, but I didn't show you how, so that's a good question. Okay, so for the makerspace, let's do multimedia production. We're gonna hope that my qualified user self turns up here, because I've already done this, but just because I'm trying to demonstrate it, it may not work. Let's see. So what it's basically telling you is how many rooms there are, who can reserve it, how many people can be in there, and all the hours and things like that. If you see here, this mm-hmm. is the scheduling for what there is. It's kind of busy today because we're doing a lot of things in the library today. But where it's green is where you can schedule. So I would personally recommend, if you want any of these multimedia spaces, you schedule for at least an hour, just in case. But let's say you just wanted this. Yeah, it automatically does it for you. Good. So you can see here, it gives you the kind of diagram. Green is available. This is what I'm trying to book. And then this red space is unavailable. So I'm trying to book it today at noon. I would submit times. Sorry, Sage, if you get this email. but basically, it will then confirm for you what you just booked. And if this is not the time you wanted, then you could remove it and start over. But it will send you an email saying, hey, remember you said you wanted to come at 12 p.m. And then you can just go over there and check in.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Sure. Anybody else? Logistical questions? No? Okay. What time is it? Oh, yes, it's almost time. So what I'll say is, once again, since y'all saw me, by all means, if you have questions or you need directions, you're more than welcome to contact me. I just likely am not the one with the knowledge base to actually help you with your research project. But if you have an interdisciplinary aspect, I did, once upon a time, I was a bio major. I know some STEM things. It's just been a long time. So feel free to reach out to me. If it's not me, I'm glad to connect you with the right person. And part of my showing you sort of these peripheral resources is if you do, let's say, create a project that you think in the end might be patentable or trademarkable, or you decide you want to start a startup, that's a whole different thing for a different presentation. But there's just a lot of stuff that the library is kind of in the middle of, is what I'll say. And it might not seem super relevant to your research right as you're doing it, but we kind of can help you connect you with the information about how to find those things. So please reach out. Yeah, you can also just come by the reference desk. We do still have one of those if you have a question in passing, or any of the service desks. We're a pretty friendly crew over there. So never any stupid questions, please come ask. And hopefully I'll see y'all at other things. Like I said, I'm unofficially kind of the grad college liaison, so I am over here a lot. And you're welcome to ask me library or non-library related things, of course. All right, that's enough.
Round of applause. Thank you.
Thanks, Zoom, folks.
Oh, yes. Thank you, folks at home. We're going to take a quick couple-minute break. So if you need to use the restroom, grab some refreshments, we're going to set up for our next session.